Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Running from the Mirror, a memoir by Howard Shulman, narrated by David Vries. 1. 3 days after his birth, a perfect baby, the carrier of his young parents' dreams and ambitions, became what some would call a monster. Like ants on honey, a bacterial infection consumed his face, and as quickly as his face disappeared, so did his mother and father. The newborn his parents had been prepared to take home and raise as their beloved son was no longer the child they had the courage to claim. I was that baby. Despite their valiant efforts, the doctors, with their arsenal of antibiotics, could not push back the bacteria's devastating aggression. When it finally ran its course, my nose, lower right eyelid, tear ducts, lips, and palate had been eaten away, leaving behind a gaping hole. Though they lasted so briefly, I can't help but imagine the joyful first days of my life. It's July 17, 1961, and I see my father, filled with youthful optimism, tapping his knuckle against the nursery window. Nodding, the nurse retrieves me from my bassinet and carries me to where he waits, his smile widening at the sight of me. Reluctantly, he turns away and heads down the brightly lit corridor to my mother's room, passing on his way a stream of immaculately starched nurses who smile at his telltale strut of new fatherhood. At his wife's door, he uprights the bouquet of yellow roses he carries and, seeing that she is sleeping, quietly crosses to her bedside. He hesitates, then bends down to press a kiss to her forehead, her eyes heavy with sleep, open. "Hello," he murmurs.
"Have you seen him?"
she asks, her words slurred. "Yes, he's perfect. Get some rest now." When he stops by the following day, he finds my mother propped up in bed, holding the bundle that is me, a look of contentment on her face. Smiling, she hands me to my father, who cradles me in his arms. "Howard. Howard. Hello, my son." On the third day in my anti-fairy tale, as my dad prepares to leave his office to visit his wife and baby, the phone rings.
"Mr. Shulman, I'm calling about your son. The doctor's voice is grave. You need to get to the hospital immediately."
"Why? What's wrong?"
"I'll explain when I see you."
"Please tell my wife I'm on my way." Oblivious to the blare of midday horns or the route he travels, my father maneuvers his car through traffic, his mind on nothing but the chilling tone of the doctor's words. His panic mounts, and he speeds toward the hospital. Out of breath, he pauses in the doorway of his wife's room, unaware that the fear he sees in her face is mirrored in his own. In two swift strides, he is at her side and reaches for her hand. She begs him to do something, anything, to make whatever is wrong right again. A faint knock announces the doctor. His jaw is tense, his eyes serious.
"Your son has contracted a staph infection in his face," he says. "He's very sick right now, but I want to assure you we're doing everything we can."
In the movie I carry in my head, I'm a healthy, robust baby nursing contentedly, the familiar rhythm of my mother's heart and sound of her voice lulling me to sleep. All is well with my world, and then, in one unmistakable shift, just as I am getting used to lights and startling noises, to alien air and strange materials assaulting my skin, I have a growing sense that something is very wrong. Suddenly, my face is on fire, and I am swallowed up in pain, my shuddering cries garbled by fluids pouring from my nose and mouth leave me gasping for breath. Sharp, biting jabs pierce my veins and tubes ravage my throat. "Where is my mother? Where is she? Why doesn't she come? Doesn't she hear me?" I scream and scream and scream until only exhaustion quiets me. My mother is gone,
and will not return, leaving me adrift on a raft of pain so unbearable that all I can do is shut down. Even before any capacity for thought has formed, I know my world has shattered. 2. Abandoned by my parents, I was made a ward of the state of New Jersey. For the next 18 years of my life, I was identified as case number XUG905. Perhaps my parents assumed or even prayed I would not survive, or perhaps they believed that without a face, their son had become something less than human, incapable of loving and being loved. Maybe wishful thinking played a part, that someone without their anguish and ego of bloodline would make me theirs and spare me the torment of failure. Whatever the basis of their decision, I know nothing about it. What I do know of those first years has been reconstructed in the manner of my face, bit by bit, stitch by stitch. I endured scores of operations, ultimately as many as 100. Unable to nurse or drink from a bottle, I was fed intravenously, my hands tethered with strips of cloth to my hospital crib to keep me from tearing at my bandages. Through it all, the one person I most wanted to reach out for had long gone. I have hazy memories of sitting in a cage-like crib, watching anonymous caretakers through the bars as they read me stories that ended too soon, abruptly returning me to the stark loneliness of institutional life in a hospital. Attachments I made never lasted, leaving me confused and unsettled by a parade of new faces. The consistent characters in my life came mostly from the stories read to me, a lifeline I grew to depend on. One book I remember had a large pop-up purple dragon, its back jagged and scaled, that both delighted and scared me. How I would hug that dragon, cuddling it as if it were my friend. The story, read to me through a plastic barrier that encased my crib to ward off infection, captivated me with its magical powers. The distant and muted words, filtered as they were through the thick, milky plastic, added to the fairy tale-like sensation of seeing the dragon as if through a mist, instilling in me the certainty that there is magic in the world. For me, this life was normal. The staff and hospital were the only family and home I'd ever known. In a strange way, I was fortunate because I had never experienced anything different. The hard part was the psychological trauma of abandonment that would develop all too soon, that mere surgery could never fix. Those wounds would take a lifetime to mend.
Howard, hold still. Just a few more things to check and we'll be done.
Recoiling at the harshness in the doctor's voice, I willed my stubby little legs to stop scissoring the chilly air. Not an easy feat, perched on his examination table with paper uncomfortably wadded under me and my anxiety mounting as I sought to avoid the rage of the man I feared. When I was days old, my medical condition had been so dire that I was transferred from the hospital in New Jersey to Montefiore Medical Center in the Bronx, and my care put in the hands of Dr. Richard Grotz. Our relationship could best be described as something akin to that of Dr. Frankenstein and his monster creation. He the demigod, and I his diminutive work in progress. As a ward of the state, and with no caseworker who understood the ramifications of experimental medical procedures or cosmetic surgery, I had no one to oversee or evaluate the merits of Dr. Grotz's ambitious plans for my treatment, and no family to protect my interests. Unrestrained, he was able to proceed with whatever means he deemed necessary to minimize my monstrosity. Right from the beginning, our relationship was fraught with tension. His unyielding long-term plans to normalize me were pitted against my fear, rebellion, resentment, and, perhaps most damaging, my mistrust. He was the one with whom I associated pain and fear and disruption of those few and far between lulls in my life when I was free from medical tampering or debilitating downtime for recovery. As the nurses, orderlies, and even janitors who showed me kindness came in and out of my life, only Dr. Grotz remained, although he was certainly no caretaker.
tall and gaunt, with gray hair buzzed painfully short. He was the picture of austerity. Accustomed to getting his way, he spoke in a voice meant to intimidate, his Eastern European accent making him all the more frightening to me. He was perfectly suited for his work. His hands were unusually large, so large they seemed to eclipse the light when he held my head in his vice-like grip to examine the state of my face. His manner, every bit as cold as his hands, was predictably mechanical and devoid of expression. I always trembled when he walked into my hospital room, never knowing what he had in store for me. I just knew it wasn't going to be fun. There was a routine to his examinations. First, he would use his hands to assess my facial structure, his long fingers exploring my features like a blind man reading Braille as he turned my head this way and that. Then he would press cold instruments against my face to map out his plans, taking his time to precisely measure me, all the while sharply reminding me to stop squirming. I learned to sit like a mannequin as he worked to tailor a custom face for me. For him, I imagine, I provided the raw material for an experiment that could catapult his career, and I'd better not get in his way. All the surgeries of my childhood have melded into one memory, the particulars of which never seem to vary. My only clue that I was slated for an operation was on the evenings when I was forbidden food or drink after an early dinner. In the unsettling darkness of pre-dawn, a hand would shake me awake and roust me from my cage. Groggy with sleep and uncooperative in my disoriented state, I'd resist being helped onto a long gurney, my whimpering, small body, a tiny island in a sea of white sheets. My favorite orderly was a jovial black man who treated me gently, almost motherly. His enormous afro mightily impressed me, reminding me of Bozo the Clown on TV. "Good morning, little man," he would say in his warm, reassuring voice. "How you doing today? Don't you be afraid of nothing. Everything is going to be A-OK. I'm right here with you." Fueled by his cheery talk, we sped along to my big sleep, as he'd call it. The gurney would follow the yellow directional tape on the gleaming gray linoleum while I watched the rows of fluorescent lights and ceiling tiles stream past overhead. Zooming down a last hallway and whipping around the corner, I'd arrive at surgery almost breathless after my thrill ride. As we parted ways, the orderly would whisper in my ear, "I'll be here when you get out, okay, little man?" I nodded solemnly before being rolled through the stainless steel doors and into the operating room. A burst of cold air would hit me, instantly triggering a ritual shivering that stemmed far more from fear than from the temperature. With my fists clenched to my stomach and my jaw chattering uncontrollably, I tried to avert my eyes from the trays of suspicious shapes hidden under white cloths, while the nurse tucked a doubled-over white blanket around my tense body as if warmth would calm me. The smell of disinfectant ratcheted up my anxiety and dread. I knew what was coming. Waiting in the room were the usual masked players, two nurses, sometimes three, an anesthesiologist, and Dr. Grotz. I can still hear him barking orders, and his underlings, as intimidated as I, scurrying to obey. "Good morning, Howard," he would say through his mask. "Are we ready?" I'm sure he was, but all I wanted was to go back to my warm bed and sleep. I never bothered to answer. What I wanted didn't matter. On center stage, under the blinding lamp, came the moment to insert the IV. It was the part I hated most, and I'd always lose it. "No, no, no! I don't want to, no!" I did everything I could to pull away as one nurse held my arm to the operating table and another wiped it down with an antiseptic sponge. I screamed in terror when I felt the prick of the numbing injection in my hand. Then the familiar warm sensation began to seep into my veins, whereupon the anesthesiologist would lean over to me to carefully fit the gas mask over my face. "Okay, Howard, count backwards for me." I never counted, but I could hear his voice fade into oblivion as he slowly recited 10, 9,
8, 7, and I was gone. Pain always awoke me. Inevitably, I would jerk on the IV in my sleep and jar the needle, triggering a blast of pain in my hand, a signal that the operation was mercifully over and I was in the recovery room. As I drifted in and out of a medicated, dreamless sleep, I gradually became aware of my fellow patients, each of us in varying states of consciousness, and lined up in rows. Back in my bed on the pediatric ward and propped up on a stack of pillows, I watched as families bearing gifts of balloons and stuffed animals crowded into our room during visiting hours. I was always acutely aware of the difference in our visitors. Mine were all in-house. Nurses, candy stripers, interns, and the night janitors mopping the floors, each dropping in to cheerfully ask how I was doing, or to slip me a treat of ice cream or a picture book. Pretending to be asleep, I would peer through the slits of my swollen eyes and scrutinize everyone, especially the mothers, who would surreptitiously glance my way. Their looks were mostly of curiosity, though sometimes I saw sympathy or concern. Even so, they never approached my bed or included me in their visits. A nurse would interrupt. "Howard, here's your juice. Drink up." Slowly I sipped through the paper straw, trying not to mash it flat, while keeping an eye on every detail of family interaction going on around me. The parents fawning over their kids. The attention the young patients milked from their mothers and fathers. The tenderness, the impatience, the worry, all of it. It was a foreign world to me. Once I could keep my juice down, the tape securing the IV to my hand would be removed. This was the dreaded moment, but my reward was Jell-O, preferably red, my favorite. It was utter hell when the nurse peeled off the adhesive tape that bound my hand and forearm to the blue styrofoam board. I would scream and cry, the tears streaming down my cheeks as the nurse calmly went about her business, ignoring my pleas. "Howard, it's okay, we're almost done." When it seemed I could take no more, the needle was out, and the nurse would stroke my brow. "Shh, honey," she'd say. "Look, it's all over." And, sure enough, my consolatory Jell-O would appear on the tray. When I was quite small, a urinal complemented my IV, but as I grew older, I was allowed to make my way to a closet-sized bathroom accompanied by an IV walker. If I could pee, I'd be given solid food, so I would stand at the sink trying to ignore the pain and hold my finger under a trickle of warm running water, which always did the trick. Then it was back to my crib, a few stuffed animals, and my 5-channel TV mounted high in the corner of my room. Though the nurses controlled the volume, I could control the channel by way of a long brown cord that snaked through the bars into my crib. I remember the Jack LaLanne show in black and white, and when I was older, Captain Kangaroo in color. Utterly captivated by the treasure house, I'd hold my breath through much of the program. During those early years, when I was confined to the hospital, TV was my most reliable companion. In 1964, when I was 3 years old, the state of New Jersey placed me in a foster home. Concerns about the long-term impact of institutional living on such a young boy, no doubt, led to the state's decision. The first time I can recall being part of a family, I was sitting on a hardwood staircase, looking down through white banisters at the living room below. This was a real house in Morristown, New Jersey, and my new mom was tying my shoelaces. Obediently, I held out each foot as I scanned the puzzling scene. Everything smelled strange, too. Rather than the sharp odor of disinfectant, the pleasant scent of something cooking filled the air, and the unfamiliar smell of freshly mowed grass drifted into the house. I also noticed that the sounds were brighter and louder. I was officially the Mackey's foster child. Ed, Big Ed, his wife Cheryl, their daughters Robin and Lisa, and their oldest, Frank, were my new family. I have no memory of meeting them in the hospital or packing my few possessions. Suddenly one day I was living with them. Their adjustment to having me in their midst must have been daunting. a scarred freak of a child with a stretch of patched-together skin in lieu of a nose, no lower right eyelid or upper lip, a gaping palate, and absolutely no social skills. In the early 60s, taking in a foster child was not a common occurrence, and though I never learned what prompted their decision, I knew that Cheryl and Ed were generous people. They had met during the Korean War in a veterans hospital in Illinois, after Ed suffered a severe concussion that sent him stateside. As he liked to tell it, I was in Korea swimming in the ocean with my buddies when enemy soldiers started chucking grenades at us. I had to keep diving, holding my breath as long as I could. I don't remember much more of his story, but this made him a war hero to me. Anyway, Cheryl nursed him back to health, and they fell in love, a classic war romance. Ed was a large, barrel-chested, dark Scot of a man with powerful, hairy forearms and a boisterous laugh, a man you needed to treat cautiously if you wanted to avoid his quick temper. A Jackie Gleason look-alike, jowls and all, he was a domineering husband and the kind of father who made it nearly impossible for his only son to ever win his approval. Raised in Brooklyn during the Great Depression, Ed jumped the sinking ship of his family at age 17 to join the Navy. His father's decision to leave when Ed was very young had imbued him with the determination to be a responsible family man. That early abandonment also left an indelible mark on his only brother, who tried to escape into alcohol, and then likewise disappeared. His mother moved to upstate New York and became a hoarder and recluse. In reaction to his clutter-filled, unstable childhood, Ed became a neat freak, compulsively cleaning and insisting everything be in its place. Incapable of sitting still, he could be found scrubbing the sink after meals, or meticulously organizing his tools on the pegboard above his workbench as he dreamed up his next project. The consummate home improvement guy, he had in Cheryl and us kids an obedient round-the-clock crew. As the oldest, Frank was given most of the responsibility for carrying out Ed's plans, which he in turn divvied out to Lisa, Robin, and me. Despite having only 6 years on me, Frank acted like he was from another generation. He had the advantage of being older, bigger, and stronger. But I always put up the good fight, never hesitating to go head-to-head against him, though I rarely won. Sharing our basement bedroom that adjoined the kids' den didn't bring us close. It was down there out of sight and earshot of parents, the linoleum flooring and wood paneling shielding the house above from our racket, that we lived out our power struggles and truces. It mattered little that we had a large bedroom since Frank's half was more like 80%. Being not only younger but also the outsider, I accepted the inequity. The basement den was our private domain. By virtue of his seniority, Frank controlled the TV, so I always had to watch his picks. Creature Feature, the late-night horror movie series, or whatever show suited his mood. If Ed and Cheryl were out, the bickering sometimes got so out of hand that even Lisa, the resident peacekeeper, would give up in disgust and retreat with Robin to our parents' bedroom to watch Shirley Temple reruns on an old black-and-white set. A fragile truce usually coincided with Frank's favorite shows. Our battles put on hold, we would sink into our beanbags chairs and soon become transfixed by the grisly horror unfolding before us. We'd mechanically stuff our faces with popcorn, and Frank, with his massive hands, would make sure to hog the lion's share. Popular among her peers, Lisa was rarely at home. Smart and pretty, with dishwater blonde hair, she was Daddy's little girl and knew how to get what she wanted. Because she was 4 years older than me, it was natural for me to fall in with Robin, who was only a year older. An exuberant, freckle-faced tomboy, she made the perfect companion. We played together constantly, whether it was chutes and ladders, go fish, or countless made-up games. Come summer, we cooled off in the backyard by running through the sprinkler, the arcs of water shimmering in the heat. To keep Ed happy, we made sure the brown spots on the lawn got watered.
Our great discovery was the secret world in the acres of undeveloped woods just across the street. We would play our games of survival, climbing rocks, crossing the swampy pond on fallen trees, and building forts with broken branches. The minute Robin rushed in the door from school and dumped her books on the stair landing, we grabbed our snacks and raced for the woods, anxious to see how our lean-tos had fared in our absence. Rusted cans and Budweiser bottles were irrefutable evidence that we were not as hidden as we had supposed. So we'd tear down our camp and venture deeper into the woods to rebuild. It was a perfect place for me, no one to gape in revulsion to remind me of my freakishness. The Mackeys were probably typical of 1,000 other Jersey suburban families, with the exception of my being their foster child. I was treated like one of them and felt loved. But inside I knew I wasn't a real Mackey. My legal name was Shulman, and Leonard and Sarah were my biological parents. On top of that, strangers never let me forget how different I was. Whenever I complained to Ed about their stares or shocked glances, he said I was imagining it, but I knew I wasn't. I felt I was living in limbo, always on the brink of something calamitous. Life seemed precarious, and without hope of adoption, which was never a realistic option because of the astronomical cost of my treatments, I remained a ward of the state. Still, Ed and Cheryl went out of their way to reassure me. "Don't you worry, Howard. You're a Mackey now, and you always will be." And it was true. I was part of the family, and included in every aspect. But it was another matter with Cheryl's parents, my grandpa and grandma. When they arrived for a visit, there were warm greetings and hugs all around, except for me. And when crisp dollars were folded into francs and my sister's fists, there was never one pressed into mine. They refused to acknowledge my place in the family, treating me politely enough, but as if I were some neighbor kid who'd happened to drop by. I knew better than to expect birthday or Christmas presents from them. While my siblings were at school, I was Cheryl's constant sidekick. She had put her nursing career on hold to be a stay-at-home mom, and although most of my care was routine, she still had a lot to learn. As my liaison with state social workers, she took on the overwhelming task of coordinating my medical scheduling. If she was ever taken aback by my evolving face, I never saw any sign of it. Not only did she feed, monitor, and mother me, she also attended my stitches and swellings, changed my bandages, and waited on me, doing it all with patience. I was 6 when I had my most radical operation to date, which was also by far the most excruciating. Dr. Gratz had decided he would use one of my left ribs to reconstruct a nose for me. This was a major procedure and meant I would be hospitalized for weeks. During my usual pre-surgery examination, Dr. Gratz attempted for the first time to explain the procedure in terms my 6-year-old mind could grasp, although he failed to mention the pain aspect. "Howard, we are going to give you a new nose, and you are going to look wonderful." Beyond that, I understood nothing of what he went on about. But when he plucked at the rib that would do the job, he caught my attention. To a young boy, a rib turning into a nose was no more outlandish than flying purple dragons. I had no power over my medical destiny and knew it. Cheryl would announce upcoming procedures and predictably I would run away. I knew it was futile, but I had no other way to protest. "I'm not going! You can't make me! I hate you!" I screamed. No words could express the rage I felt. Viciously, I lashed out, kicking chairs, the kitchen cabinets, whatever lay in my path. Slamming the screen door behind me, I'd tear off into the woods, choking on tears. When I reached the pond, I would launch an aerial attack of sticks and stones into the murky water, and when that failed to quench my fury, I blindly turned on leaves, dirt, cans, and trees, attacking everything around me. Finally spent, I could do nothing more than stare down at my disfigured face, floating on the watery surface, my features even more distorted in the reflection. I would lob a rock at my face,
sending schools of minnows darting away. With nightfall looming, or when I could no longer bear the cold, I would grudgingly turn homeward in defeat, knowing I had yet again lost the fight that couldn't be won. Cheryl never mentioned my absence, but was visibly relieved when I trudged in the door. "You hungry, kiddo?" was all she'd say. I was not Ed. Food would not placate me or distract me from my anger and frustration. Hell-bent on unloading my last shred of rage, I turned on her. "You're not my real mother. You can't tell me what to do." Never revealing the hurt she must have felt, she would gently reply, "Kid, I'm the only mother you got." Then I'd slump over the kitchen table and weep. Cheryl was right. She was all I had. After the nose operation, I recall nothing until I woke up in my own room and found I had been promoted to an adult bed with retractable side railings instead of my usual kitty cage. This was a big deal for me and almost a consolation for the pain I had to endure. Though I took shallow breaths to keep my rib cage still, it felt as if a knife was repeatedly plunged into my side and sadistically turned. I was afraid to move. I had to stay bedridden for what seemed like weeks, unable to watch TV because my eyes had swelled shut. Eventually, I was allowed to shuffle to the bathroom, but the slightest wrong movement set off spasms of pain that careened around my ribcage and left me gasping. I returned home thin and demoralized. My appearance even shocked Frank, who was actually nice to me. When I could drag myself to the den, feeling and looking like a decrepit old man, Robin did everything she could to keep my spirits up, coming downstairs to watch TV or play board games and bringing me up on all the latest neighborhood news. Even so, it was a very dark time for me. The day came when hunger returned with a vengeance. Impatiently, I called up the stairs for Cheryl to bring me some food. "Mom? Mom? Mom!" It hurt to yell. Where was she? Outside? On the phone? In the bathroom? Ravenous, I was going to get to the kitchen by whatever means I could. From the bottom of the stairs, I looked up to the first landing and wondered how I could possibly make it. But the growling in my stomach spurred me to action. Gingerly pulling myself up by the handrail, I cried from the pain of it, and my bandage, soggy with tears, soon slid over my nose. After considerable effort, I had managed only a few steps. This wasn't going to work. So I turned around, sat down, and began to negotiate of each step but first, resting between each to steel myself for the next maneuver. Just as I was nearing the first landing, Cheryl appeared and leaned out over the top banister.
"Howard, what on earth are you doing?"
"I'm hungry," I said in a small voice. I was afraid I had upset her, but that fear vanished when she ran down the stairs and gently picked me up in her arms. I had lost so much weight on my liquid diet that she easily carried me to the kitchen. Despite my swollen eyes, unwieldy bandage, and a ribcage that hurt to move, I savored every morsel of meatloaf. Never had I worked so hard to get food, and never had it tasted so good. At dinner that evening, Cheryl related my stairs adventure as she portioned out the hamburger helper. Ed was not one to show his feelings, though his family meant everything to him. He had a soft spot for his girls, but was tough on Frank, and never cut me any slack either. Convinced I would need to hone some serious survival skills if I was to fend for myself out in the world, he took on the daunting task of teaching me independence. To achieve that, and do so with compassion, was no small undertaking. Coddling me, he decided, would not be in my best interest. When Cheryl finished her story, Ed turned to me and smiled proudly. "Kid, you and me are the same. We're survivors. You're gonna be okay." Rare praise, but I sensed he believed it. And so did I, somewhere deep within me. For the most part, it was a happy home in the suburbs, a white clappered, two-story colonial with a large yard, lots of trees, and two cars. Cheryl's blue Valiant, along with a family car, a wood-paneled station wagon. Ed commuted every day to Manhattan, where he worked at a bookbindery. He never tired of regaling us with how he had started at the bottom and finally, after years of dedication, was made supervisor. His status secure, signaled by his necktie that set him apart from the assembly line workers under him, he could survey his little fiefdom of cubicles through the sliding glass doors of his small office. Ambitious and knowing he wouldn't get any unearned breaks, he often worked evenings and weekends doing construction. Despite his habitual bitching about how rotten his day had been and his quick temper that could flare like a brush fire, all of us admired him. "Don't be like everyone else, Howard," Ed would tell me. "Work hard, and don't take crap from anybody." That was his philosophy, and he never let me forget it. I already knew I wasn't like anyone else, so he didn't have to remind me about that. I was, however, working on the part about not taking crap from anybody. Ed always made Cheryl nervous when he announced a new project. A perfectionist, he was obsessive about detail. "Make sure the bubble is in the middle of the level," he'd bark at me. "Is it in the middle yet? You sure? Check it again." I carefully eyed the level until it was dead center, and Ed would drill in the screws. Then he'd assign me to sweep up the debris. "Howard, listen to me," he'd say as the two of us stepped back to admire our work. "If you're going to do something, do it once, do it right, or don't do it at all. You got it?" Though in most regards Ed overshadowed Cheryl, he counted on her quiet strength. Slight and fair, evidence of her Dutch forebears, she was strong when it came to matters she was unwilling to compromise on. Refusing to get swallowed up in the density of Ed's shadow, she knew that confrontations weren't the way to handle him. Skillfully and subtly, she manipulated him. In her rare quiet time, as Cheryl called it, which was usually at the kitchen table in the early morning hours while her family slept, or during Johnny Carson's Tonight Show, Ed's favorite, she escaped to her books. Bella Abzug, Gloria Steinem, and Erica Jong filled her bedroom bookcase, and while never a card-carrying feminist, she did smoke Virginia Slims. Cheryl kept her newfound "I'm okay, you're okay" outlook to herself, but through example instilled that attitude in her children. The summer before I started school, the chore of painting the floor of our enclosed back porch fell to Frank. Ed, under pretense of majority rule, brought home an array of color samples to get everyone's feedback, even though he had already chosen navy blue. To preclude rogue input, he held up the color chip. "The only choice, right?" "Perfect," Cheryl said, regardless of her preference. After purchasing the paint and instructing Frank, Ed returned home hours later to find his son had literally painted himself into a corner. Big Ed had no humor where Frank was concerned and was not a happy camper, as Cheryl always put it. Bracing himself for Ed's tirade, Frank suggested he could just climb out through the window. "Jesus Christ, what is wrong with you?" Ed roared. "You're not going to tear off the goddamn screen. I just replaced it. You stay put until the paint dries." He stormed off, shaking his head, leaving Frank marooned. Cheryl motioned to him from the doorway. "Hang on, Frank." She ducked around the corner of the house with me close behind, pried off the screen, and freed Frank. If Ed had had his way, Frank would have spent the night squatting in that corner. Food was Cheryl's single greatest weapon in dealing with Ed, and she knew now was the time to deploy it. "Our beautiful new porch. This calls for a celebration." Before Ed could get himself worked up, we were packed into the station wagon and on our way to his favorite culinary establishment, a Howard Johnson's off the New Jersey Turnpike. Frank knew the routine and needed no reminder to slump, making himself appear younger, so he could pass for the cheaper all-you-can-eat kiddies menu, usually fried clams. After consuming half of Chesapeake Bay, Ed, satiated and happy, returned to the newly painted porch, his disgust with Frank forgotten. To prepare me for school, Cheryl became my first teacher. She would make use of any spare time, during lunch, in the car or waiting room, at bedtime, to drill me on spelling, reading, and math, using flashcards for my multiplication tables whether or not I was bandaged.
Okay, Howard, what's 3 times 6? She always made it fun and understood how well I responded to encouragement. Those moments with Cheryl were our private time together that no one else knew about. One day, as I was eating my lunch at the kitchen table and watching Cheryl gaze distractedly out the window as she dried her hands, I blurted out, "Does my face bother you?" She turned toward me, the dish towel forgotten in her hands, and the question hanging in the air between us as she studied my face. I suppose I just wanted reassurance, or maybe I was curious about what she thought about me. But her silence was making my question more serious than I had intended. Slowly, she began to speak, her eyes locked on mine. "Howard, how could you think such a thing? You have beautiful brown eyes and lovely hair. Besides, you're my Howie." Her response surprised me. No one had ever used the word beautiful in conjunction with me. "Honey, I'm a nurse, and believe me, I've seen much worse."
"Worse? How could it be worse?"
"When I worked in the hospital, I saw people terribly burned, and I've treated people without arms or legs and others who were completely blind. Believe me, honey, you're not so bad." I tried to envision myself without arms or legs, propped up at the table eating my lunch, but the image wouldn't form. After my ribs healed and the new graft had taken, as Dr. Grotz would say, it was time to begin my formal education. My social worker and the state of New Jersey decided I'd do best in a school for kids with special needs. Their descriptions of high teacher-to-child ratio and the individual attention I would receive seemed ideal, so Ed and Cheryl went along with it. For weeks, my family prepared me. "Howie, you'll be taking the bus to school just like the other kids. Think how many new friends you'll make. You'll have recess and lunch and art and music and games. You're going to love it." The night before I started was torturous. I lay in bed, too terrified to cry, and tried to muffle my moans in my pillow so Frank wouldn't wake up and torment me for being a baby. Why had I wanted this? What was I thinking? I had enough problems with the kids in my neighborhood. I was used to name-calling and teasing, but how would I be treated in school? Had Cheryl taught me enough so they wouldn't think I was a dummy? Would I be able to keep up with the class? Would I make any real friends? In the morning, exhausted and anxious, I climbed the stairs to the kitchen to find Frank, Lisa, and Robin at the breakfast table. "Howie's first day of school," Cheryl announced as she gave me a hug, no doubt sensing the state of my nerves. Robin, who was cheerful even in the morning, told me not to worry. "You'll feel weird the first day, Howie, but after you get to know some kids, you'll see how much fun it is." Ed, his hip jutted against the counter, studied us as he downed his morning coffee. Seeing the time, he grabbed his jacket and rushed out the door, calling out as he did every morning, "Have a good day, gang. Gotta pay the bills." Never once did I see him smile when he left for work. Unusually talkative that morning, Cheryl tried to distract me. In honor of my first day of school, she walked me down to the bus stop, my hand in hers. The excitement and fear I felt was more than first-day jitters. When my bus pulled up, my heart sank. I already knew about the short bus that came before the regular one, so every kid in the neighborhood got to see the freaks being loaded. I was certain that my fellow passengers would not be like the kids boarding Robin's bus that I had watched so often through our front window. When the doors opened wide, the sounds emitting from the interior almost paralyzed me. I looked back to see Cheryl smiling and giving little encouraging flaps with her hands for me to get moving. I stepped onto the landing and froze. I truly couldn't move. My new kids might as well have been glued to the rubber flooring. Except for the whooshing hiss of the doors closing behind me, all sound receded, my mind emptying as I tried to comprehend what I was seeing. I stood facing a cargo of writhing kids strapped into their wheelchairs and seats, children yammering unintelligibly and twitching uncontrollably, yelling and drooling and swiveling their eyes. One kid, seated at the back among others who seemed comatose or unnaturally happy, rocked rhythmically to music no one else heard. Thinking, surely,
Any second now, I would wake up from this nightmare. I somehow got my body to move forward. Spotting a vacant one-person jump seat, I sat down and withdrew as far as I could, pressing my side into the cold, steel shell of the bus. In a daze, I looked out the window where Cheryl stood on the sidewalk, clutching her red and green plaid JCPenney bathrobe at her throat. She waved her free hand enthusiastically as she mouthed a big, smiling goodbye and then blew a parting kiss. The situation became more surreal as we bounced along our circuitous route. A half hour later, the bus pulled up to what appeared to be an abandoned warehouse. After we were unloaded and formed into a line reminiscent of a circus sideshow parade, our pitiful little group was escorted, snaking and lurching across a bleak playground of packed dirt, and then down a ramp to a basement entrance. When the door opened to our classroom, the screaming and wailing of earlier arrivals assaulted my ears, and the scene before me looked like something out of one of Frank's horror movies. Four teachers, who acted more in the capacity of caretakers, were trying unsuccessfully to establish order. Several kids were armored in football helmets so they wouldn't split their heads open, and everywhere was a tangle of flailing arms and legs. Tacked on the walls in the art corner were meager attempts at self-expression, little more than a few random lines and blotches of thin color daubed on brown butcher paper. My impression of being in a warehouse had not been an exaggeration. This was an underground holding pen where kids with terrible challenges were stored 8 hours a day. And that's when it hit me. This was the bottom of the bottom, and I was in it. As if from a great distance, I became aware of a woman slowly repeating in a loud voice, "You must be Howard!" Trying to answer but rendered almost mute by the sights and sounds and smells around me, I struggled to refocus. I glanced at the open folder in her hands and saw a black-and-white photo of me clipped to the inside cover. Not wanting to believe it myself, I managed a meek yes, thinking this must be a horrible mistake. This couldn't be my school. I knew with absolute certainty I didn't belong with these kids. At that point, though, I was so deathly afraid it was my destiny that I could barely speak. "How are you, Howard?" She spoke slowly, as if that would help me understand the question, apparently interpreting my facial deformities as marginal IQ. After leading me to a low table where a square box sat next to wooden blocks of various shapes, she explained even more slowly the object of the game, to see if I could match the blocks to their appropriate openings. Was she kidding? This wouldn't challenge a toddler. I was 6 years old, and Cheryl and I had been working on long division flashcards. Thinking I hadn't understood her directions, the teacher began explaining once again, but I cut her off and completed the task that presumably I was to struggle with all morning, solving it in seconds. "Very good, Howard!" I wondered what she had thought I would do with them. We moved on to a worksheet that I was to fill in with the numbers 1 through 10. She seemed impressed by my answers and, after jotting a few notes in my file, left me to draw on a piece of brown paper she tore from a giant roll. Even at my young age, I knew that we were on lockdown and that this was no school. My impulse was to make a run for it, but a quick assessment of the doors, secured with multiple locks, nixed that idea. Escape through the windows wasn't an option either. All the glass was embedded with chicken wire. Near panic, I found it difficult to breathe, and the smell of urine made me queasy. The place was demoralizing beyond anything I'd ever imagined. The walls were stained and painted a dreary beige, and the kids, well, I had no words for them. I could see nowhere to turn and knew no one would listen to me. I wanted to scream that this was all wrong and demand that I be sent home now. I was trapped. It felt like I was back in my hospital cage, only worse. I thought I had known misery before, but in that basement, I experienced a new low. The kids with multiple sclerosis, Down syndrome, and every degree of mental disability were one thing, but the hollering and moaning and smells were what drove me crazy. At last, shell-shocked but home again, I tried to make Cheryl understand what she'd sent me off to. She had to fix it. Anything would be better than that place. I begged her, but Cheryl, being Cheryl, told me to be patient, that the first day of school was difficult for everyone and that I would adjust and make friends and everything would be fine. Give it time, Howie. My anguish continued much the same for the next few months, bracketed by the dread of each morning and the relief of returning home at the end of the day. I graduated in reading to see Spot Run, but at that point I didn't care. Depressed and humiliated by the short bus signaling to the world how deficient I was, I resigned myself to the hellish situation I lived through each and every school day. Finally, my despondency grew so severe it could no longer be denied, and Cheryl realized that something indeed was very wrong. She conferred with my social workers and teachers, who concluded that they had made a mistake. Mercifully, I didn't have to return to that wretched warehouse. My next placement was just another form of torment, but one I welcomed nonetheless. I was transferred to Hillcrest Elementary in Morristown, New Jersey, a school in the suburbs that was, I was happy to note, above ground. From my classroom, unobstructed by chicken wire, I had a view of swing sets, merry-go-rounds, and playing fields beyond. Hillcrest was my first experience in a mainstream public school. My years sequestered in hospitals and later with my foster family had never exposed me to hordes of kids, so I was unprepared for the degree of outrage I would trigger in the school bullies. Sure, some of the kids in my neighborhood gave me a hard time, but they all had their own cliques, and I didn't figure prominently in their sights. This was different, and I had no skills to defend myself other than trying to ignore their onslaught. To help me make friends, Cheryl convinced me to join Cub Scouts. That lasted one meeting, when I got booted out for punching a mean scout who picked the wrong person to bully. Only rarely did I participate in group activities, except for occasions like trick-or-treating when everyone was caught up in the excitement of Halloween and had their attentions elsewhere. Masked, I could be forgiven my freakishness, but the irony was that my own face would have been far more frightening. Still, for one short, glorious night, I could escape my reality. At school, though, there would be no reprieve. My joy at being released from the subterranean school did little to sustain me when I met the cruelty awaiting me at Hillcrest. From day one, the vicious verbal assaults slung at me were relentless. Initially, only a couple of kids targeted me, but quickly it escalated to small groups. My very existence seemed to offend them. To those kids, I was different in a way that would never be acceptable. For me, there would be no entry into their circles. Even Robin, who was always ready to defend me and loyally sat next to me on the bus to shield me from the inevitable taunting, which generally worked because she was popular, couldn't protect me once we parted ways. When I headed off alone to my classroom, I had to brace myself for a barrage of jabs. Every name the kids could think up was slung at me. Retard, pig boy, flat nose, bug eyes, freakoid. None of them original, but all accurate in their capacity to wound. Resorting to my own wits to get through the day however I could, I at first tried to follow Cheryl's advice, ignore them, and they would eventually get bored and leave me alone. It never worked out that way. I doubt I could have survived the daily torment if it hadn't been for my wonderful teacher, Mrs. Marriott. Young, blonde, and pretty, she wore colorful miniskirts like the ones I saw on the Mod Squad, making her cool in all our eyes. I adored her. If she caught kids mistreating me, she ended it quickly, sending a clear message that their behavior would not be tolerated. The message she sent to me was that she cared. Somehow, without showing favoritism, she raised my confidence, praising me when I did well, so despite the fierce hostility I constantly struggled with, I blossomed under her tutelage. I earned my share of tiny gold stars and even found the courage to read aloud in class, a huge step for me. Proud that I easily kept up with the class.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.